To recall the November 7th meeting of the school committee to order. And first order of business is to review the minutes of October 6th.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, financial statements.
Okay, so tonight I gave you, I handed out, but I also did send you early. Proud of myself for that.
Yes, Patty, I want to say thank you to Patty because it's so cool everyone gets to see.
So the first thing I want to draw your attention to is on page 4. And about 5 lines from the bottom, there's an account called Expense Insurance Contract Adjustments.
Yep.
And there's $37,675.57 sitting in there. This is the difference between what, when we budgeted last December, we did not have a contract. We did not know what the contract was going to come in. We also didn't, our health insurance benefits that you pay for central office weren't solidified either as far as rates. This is, I have now adjusted all the accounts, and this is what is remaining in that account. Well, before I say that, I'm going to go look again, but I'm pretty sure I didn't remember everything.
Where are the benefits? Where do they come through?
The benefits for the teachers through the town. The town pays them.
So they're not in this budget?
No. They just give me a figure at the end of the year, and I put that on the end of the year report.
Okay.
So it's counted towards our net school spending, but we don't pay it. We don't contract for it.
Okay.
So yes, so we have what remaining $37,676. And I'd like to bring to you for your consideration if we could transfer $3,700 to the building security and testing line, testing and inspections. That was something I wanted to do during the budget season so that our recurring testing and inspection costs are out of our repairs. I've been trying to create a new budget line. So I would recommend that we take $3,700 and create that budget line. And then if you look on page 5, we are paying the physical therapy and the occupational therapy salaries out of school choice, and I'd like to bring those onto our budget as well, and that would be about $25,500, and that would leave about $8,400 in this account for getting us through the winter if we have any problems with roofs or exhaust fans or whatever else, and then relook at it in spring, and if we still have that money we don't have any overages in any big account, we could possibly make a purchase or another repair at that time, or transfer more salaries from school choice.
So why do we have 37,000 though? Is that, did you overestimate
yes.
that there would be more costs?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
We budgeted high and came in low for our first year.
And so
year.
Those are set for how many years?
Three now.
3 years.
Committee's pleasure.
So can you just tell me what the 25,500 is going to take care of? Is that what you said, 25,500?
25,500, it'll take care of the physical therapy and the OT salaries for the rest of the year that
okay.
would have been going into school choice. We'll bring them on our budget.
Okay.
And free up our school choice money.
Well, what happens next year? Will it be part of the budget next year, or will it be part of school choice money?
It'll be part of the budget. So when we start okay. the budget next week, it'll be part of this budget.
Okay. What kind of increase are we talking about for those two line items, approximately, for percentages of our?
I didn't bring my calculator.
Okay.
I'm math shy.
I'm just worried that if it's.
Does anybody have a calculator?
If it's too much.
No, that isn't gonna be. It'll be a washout.
It's in the budget.
It's in the budget
for this year.
Right.
So here we'll have an issue.
We'll start at this year's budget, right. and it'll be in there already. That'll actually
okay.
reduce our school choice.
Right. Are you? Yeah. Right.
Right. What I'm saying is, but we're gonna have an increase.
No.
In our, won't.
No.
It'll. The only thing that'll show is the increase to what the contract
actual.
Is. So whatever the contract increase is for FY18,
okay.
which I think is either 2 or 2.5. I know one, I think, I'm not sure if it's Frontier or Union or both. It was 1, 2.5, 2.5.
Okay.
So it'll be the 2.5%.
I just didn't know if, since it wasn't part of the budget before, we're making part of the budget, That means our overall dollars.
No.
No, because I'm just transferring.
Dollars of state to state?
Right.
You're just transferring money within your budget.
Okay.
If you look at the bottom, our general fund appropriation is $1,599,454. That will stay the same. I'm just reallocating the dollars.
Okay. Got it.
Everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Make a motion to allow the transfer to $25,500 to...
Salaries.
Salaries and the $3,702. I didn't see what line item that was.
It's called, if you go up one, two, three, four, five from where we're talking, it's zero, but this month was spent with $663.75. That's our testing and inspection line.
Okay.
And I've been wanting to pull that out of our repairs and maintenance because it really takes up a good chunk of it. So I've been trying in each school to establish its own line.
So we're going to transfer $3,700 to that line?
$700 to that line.
Okay.
Correct. And then we'll revisit this in the spring.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Okay. First was Katie?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, who's second?
Actually, it was first Bob. Make the motion, Katie second.
Well, I will change it. Do you mind being called Katie, or do you like to be called Catherine?
Katie.
Katie?
She looks like a Katie.
Well, the O'Hara is the thing that I love.
That's my dad. When I'm in trouble.
You must have hated giving up.
The only time I heard Donald was when I was in...
My good actual name.
Anything else?
Not on here, but I do want to bring your attention to the element, the 14 through 16 school lunch. This was something that our school committee person, Katie Edwards, had recommended if I put it in this format, and I really found this helpful. It took me a while to get the data in this format, but once it's there, this is so much clearer.
Mm-hmm.
Things are popping out at me that I didn't notice before.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the numbers in the boxes, so we have, the first numbers are the total revenues. So in 14, we had $47,341. 15, we went down to $46,930. And in 16, we fell down to $44,766. Now, the next is the number of meals in each of our price categories, our full price meals, our reduced price meals, and our free price meals. And if you notice, the reduced really changes between 15 and 16. And so note the free and the free lunch. And that is because the feds changed the way that we count free and reduced.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all direct cert now. So it was like they shook the whole, you know, put all the puzzle pieces and shook them back out again.
Okay.
And this is what happened. So our full went up and our reduced went down.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the next section, that's how much we're actually getting. If I divide the full price revenues by the total meals, our revenue for a full price meal was $314, $315, and $316. The revenue for the reduced was $290 a meal, $290 a meal, and then $299. And our free lunch went from $304, $310 to $319. Now, what's really interesting is when we look at the cost per meal. So if we look at FY16, our cost per meal was $4.08. Well, our highest revenue is $3.19.
We're losing money on
every meal. So this isn't really where we need to focus our attention, is on our expenses and reducing our expenditures. But what was interesting too, while we were doing this, brings us up, I'm gonna ask for a motion tonight, I'm gonna tell you about the issue tonight, you'll have time to consider it, and we'll vote in December. But underneath the block, I broke down for you how I get to those numbers, the 316, the 299, and the 319. So our students pay $2.75 for a lunch. The state reimburses us 6 cents this year. The Fed gives us 29 cents, and then we get an additional 0.06 cents because our menus meet the new dietary. So our total paid lunch, we're getting $3.16. $2.75 comes from our parents, and the rest comes from the Feds. Same thing, that's how you get to the $2.99 on a reduced. And then our free, and this is where we have the problem. If you look on 16, we are getting $2.78 from the Feds. But we're only charging our parents $2.75. We can't be below the federal free lunch reimbursement. Mm. So we now need to raise our lunch prices.
Now, don't tell them that I put this together.
Well, probably a good thing we picked up on it.
Yes. So what I would recommend is that we, and what, it scares me to say raise our prices, because we do need to generate more revenue, but I also don't want to kill our participation by pricing us out, that parents can't afford lunches, especially parents of multiple children in the schools. So I'm only looking to raise it to 280 or 285 as of January 1st. 280 will probably buy us 17, and we'd have to raise it again. If we raise it to 285, we can probably get through 18 and 19.
So if it's at 275 now.
285.
What's 10 cents more, make it 295? Maybe we don't have to touch it for a long time.
Well, that's 20 cents.
Do you have any sense, can I ask a question?
10%.
Why the full pay revenues dropped so much in the last year? Because
it's the participation.
That's also kind of notable,
right.
I think.
The participation definitely fell off. So right. There's a couple of things that we can do. And what's hard here is because we're still all manual. We're not using a computerized system. But when I see that, I want to know what are our popular meals? Mm-hmm. Like, what are the days that the kids all want to eat? And it's probably chicken nugget day. Let's be honest. You know, these are kids from K, you know, to six. So I would love to do some analysis on what are our popular lunches, what are our least popular lunches, and those least popular lunches, drop them off. You know, start introducing something else that might grab the kids.
Mm-hmm.
I
used to love the little English muffin pizzas. Those were one of my favorites, man. Those little things.
I thought you still ate them.
I still do make them at home.
I want something a little bigger.
I could probably say a few things about it, but that's only because I've been asking. I've been walking around and just asking kids, you know, how do you feel about breakfast for lunch, you know? And some kids say, oh, I love it, I can't wait to have it. And other kids say, yeah, I already had breakfast today, but, you know.
Right.
So I couldn't really say in a numbers way. I only mm-hmm. know sort of anecdotally what kids like. I mean, I'm guessing that, I know I've talked with Kathy, too, you know, who dishes out all the meals every day, and, you know, spaghetti with meat sauce, kids really like that. Chicken nuggets, kids absolutely like
mac
that.
Mac and cheese, I mean, do they do
there
mac
are some
cheese?
Things, though, that kids, you know, the count goes down, you know, I mean, that, and that's part of what we need to know, is what yeah. when does the count drop, and when does it climb, and can we introduce new things to the menu that'll be popular?
Because you want to keep the full price as high as possible. Like, you want as right. many of those meals to be sold as possible.
Exactly. So one of the things that I was thinking was that now that we have Power School, I was going to ask Scott Paul, what would be the cost of now bringing the computerized lunch system to Whately so that we can have live data every week and say, okay, this was a success, this wasn't a success, and start getting some live time mm-hmm. data. And maybe with the moving of the school choice money, saving some school choice, if it's reasonable, maybe we can invest in the computerized system, and that may also help us to reduce our labor costs.
Expenses, right.
Our labor costs, yeah.
You might also want to ask the parents, because really the parents are deciding whether or not they're going to have the, like, in our house we just decide 2 days a week.
Correct.
And it doesn't, like, the menu is sort of more when she picks, when she wants it. It's not so much that she gets more than that. So you might want to talk to the parents about, like, what do they think.
And that's not a bad idea. We could send out, like, maybe a Survey Monkey and ask the parents some questions. You know, what would you like to see? You know, what don't you like? What do you like? You know.
We actually did that at the at Frontier. The student council has a survey that they developed mm-hmm. Asking about their favorite lunches, and the students are actually this week filling it out. Mm-hmm. And we could certainly, you know, do something like that here. Another thing that they did was they just put a big paper on the wall and had the kids just go up and put a little tally mark on
next to what they
meals.
Like. Yeah. And that the kids, I think, is great, and it would be good to know what they like, but I think the parents need to weigh in because they're really deciding more,
correct.
At least on the money side.
Right.
One thing that we're really lucky about in this school is they have homemade soup every day, and it's wonderful, mm-hmm. and they have a wonderful salad bar. I mean, it's amazing to
do the kids eat it.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's
The kids often will get a small soup to go with their lunch, and the same with the salad bar, is that they can go and get a small container and add a few things, you know, for their, to their lunch meal. Mm-hmm. But again, the question is not what, you know, what do I see sort of just in passing, really, but really what the numbers are.
And that's, but I like the idea of surveying the parents.
Okay, maybe we can work, maybe we can work on that with some questions.
Maybe you can model it after the student council from Frontier.
Yeah, we could do that.
You don't have to reinvent the wheel, but I think it would be good information.
Okay, we'd be happy to do that. So do you want to consider the 280, 285, and now Mr. Hollis, 295, and then vote in December? I just want to give parents enough leeway. Mm-hmm. We will be meeting the first week of December, so that will give us enough time to prepare for the pricing increase that will go into effect after Christmas break.
Do you remember when we went to 275?
No. I think it was my first year here because they hadn't been raised.
It's been a while.
Yeah. This is my
but
fifth year.
It went
year.
From 250, yeah. I think, to 275.
I think
I'm
you're right.
I'm just thinking if, you know, if you're going to go 10 cents.
I don't know. $3 is nice and even. Like when you're actually giving out the money, it's hard to have an amount that's like 295 if you're using cash.
Well, my experience with anytime you increase the school lunch, participation goes down for a while. Mm-hmm. And then it comes back a little bit. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think some parents that have, you know, multiple kids in the school, it's a burden for
right.
some of them. So I'm hesitant on really increasing it a lot. Mm-hmm.
If we go from, you know, 275 to 285, that's 10 cents. That's, you know, 50 cents a week.
Yeah.
A dollar if mm-hmm. you have two children.
So, I mean, we got time to think about it till December.
Mm-hmm. Is that when we're going to vote on it?
Well, I didn't want to have to come, because we can wait till January.
I think it's a good idea to wait.
I think this will give you time to think about it, and then we'll put it on the agenda for December to vote.
Maybe we can get that survey
done prior.
Prior to that, to give us an idea of 10 cents, 20 cents, you know.
I mean, if you're going to do the survey, ask the parents.
Yeah,
you know, explain in there, you know, a little blurb that we have to increase to match.
If they know, we're in a hole.
Well, it's not that we're in a hole. We're matching the feds at this point.
We're in a hole, $7,000.
Well, I know that, Bob. I know that.
You know, it's.
But when you increase, you decrease.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll do that. I'll work with Pete to get a survey together.
We can get the senior citizens of this town to come in and eat lunch here.
I don't even eat lunch at home. Rarely.
Okay. Of course, I was looking at you.
I'm so busy, Bob.
Oh,
I don't have time.
Eating chocolate.
I don't eat chocolate.
So this is a nice.
Thank you, Patty.
Yeah, this is really nice.
Thank you for recommending it, Katie. It really was helpful. It even opened my eyes into what some of the issues were.
Yeah.
So the format was excellent.
Okay. Look at me. Okay. Yeah.
So I think that takes care of update on cafeteria under unfinished business.
We didn't do public comment.
Oh, sorry.
Right. Nobody's here. All right. Okay. Tree damage. Who wants to speak to that?
Well, the three of us were at the meeting, and I defer to Bob or Don.
Well, I'll take it.
Okay.
Is that why Bob is here, about the trees, too?
No, he's here about the Green Community Grant. Bob wasn't there, but this Bob was.
You were there.
You were at the meeting.
Well,
you said.
What are you talking about? Have another chocolate.
I heard you guys were all there.
Hey. Let's restate that. Don will talk about it.
Yes, Don will talk about it.
Apparently, Bob's a little deficient because he didn't eat dinner.
That's what it is.
Hey, I had my 30th anniversary this past week, and I bought her a birthday card and a birthday bag, not an anniversary card. That's how far out I've been.
Yikes.
When is
but I did buy her an iPad, so, you know.
All right. Who cares what it comes in?
Right, yeah, that's what I'm saying. I get that.
Well, I was way out there with it. Oh, nice bag, nice card. Happy 30 years, 30 more coming.
Oh.
And then she says, who's the birthday bag for? Yeah.
Okay, well, Don?
Don, right. You want to give us an update down on that?
With that said, I'll give you an update. We met with the Board of Selectmen. They had received our letter, and they support the idea of pursuing the Sanderson property. The first thing that has to be done is that an appraisal have to be done to, because we can't, the town cannot pay more than the appraised value of the property. And so I asked the other day, one of our selectmen, if they heard it on the appraisal, and he hadn't. So hopefully they'll get that done fairly soon. A lot of discussion about what the barrier should be. I think we pretty much agreed that trees would be the answer, but there was still question about any, you know, overspray or that. But if we do purchase the land, it puts us further back in a buffer zone, which makes me feel more comfortable. So I think we're moving in the right direction. We talked about plans for that. You know, if we were to do a parking lot or whatever, doesn't have to be done right away. We can move when we at our leisure on that. So I think that's it in a nutshell. So we're moving along, and that has to be voted at town meeting. If they agree on a price with Sanderson's, that'll have to be brought to a special town meeting, and I believe they're doing it in December.
December, I think they have one.
So hopefully all the ducks are in a row, and it's in their ballpark right now.
Don, is a special town meeting just for that, or is it?
No, there's several articles.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, did you say when that special town meeting was?
I don't know the date.
I don't know the date, but all
right.
I've heard December.
So we talked about the barrier, and did we talk about the specific tree of the barrier? I don't remember that.
No.
We talked about that, no. But we talked about whether the barrier would be further or closer.
Right, and we talked about pines and abrevieties. Keith did have a arborist come in, and he has a recommendation. So I think we'll probably end up following the recommendation of the arborist. But at any rate, irregardless if we purchase the land or not, something has to be done out there, and that has to be done in the spring. Or it doesn't have to be, but that's where we're going for spring. So that's my report on that. Green Community Grant, where are we?
Sorry, it's December 1st. It's December 1st.
Oh, the special town meeting?
The special town meeting.
Isn't that our meeting?
No, that's a Thursday. I don't know, is that?
Oh, okay. December 1st is a Thursday?
Mm-hmm. Is that the joint meeting?
No.
7:30.
So it's going to be on the 4th, okay.
Okay, the Green Communities Grant. We bid that project a couple months ago, and the town sent a purchase order to CTC, Control Center, the people that are going to be doing that installation. They've sent back submittals on it, they've ordered material, and they're going to start work tomorrow. So the project to do the energy management system here in the school should go pretty quickly, and that spends $73,780. Of the Green Communities Grant. We were kind of surprised with where the pricing on that came in. We originally had a study done, and the town actually had the study done. They had an individual, Bart Fields, took a look at several different options, and we picked the energy management system because it kind of looked like it fit the grant money, although even the estimate on that was a little bit higher, so we asked them to bid it with an option. And it came in, you know, we had figured the price was going to be $160,000, $170,000. It came in at $73,000, which is awesome. I'm surprised. Although I know the vendor that bid on it, and they're good people. They've done good work for us, so I have no issues with that. Mm-hmm. Brian has suggested that if we can come up with something that'll show some energy savings, we can do additional work. Mm-hmm.
Can we just back up a second?
Yep.
My memory serves me correctly. When we talked about this last, mm-hmm. we had the 73,780, mm-hmm. and you were talking about there was some other components.
That's some of what I need to talk with Brian and Patty about. I'm not sure now that we've bid that project, what if anything we can add to the project as a you know, an extra work as opposed to bidding additional work. There's two small items. One has to do with the boiler control and the three-way valve, and the other one has to do with the exterior parking lot lighting. Those two projects together are going to be somewhere between $4,500 and $5,000 that would add in and would be an extra to the contract, I'm hoping.
So we can get three quotes on that. So if we have CTC price it and then get two other quotes from Lights companies, then we'll be okay.
Well, but part of it is they both interface with the controls. The small amount there, you know, for $5,000, bidding it would be difficult.
I'm not saying we have to bid it. I said we just need to get other quotes. Yeah.
Or we can do the same thing we did with the energy management system. And
no one else responded.
Yeah,
I'll talk to Brian and see what he's comfortable with.
Now, over and above that, I'm meeting tomorrow here with the owner of the company, CTC. He's proposing what I think is a really good project, but I'm not sure we can put it together quick enough for the grant. He's suggesting that we put new motors on all of the HVAC equipment and variable speed drives. The energy savings on that is substantial. It's probably almost, it's probably as much, if not more, than the work that they're already doing. And he said by tomorrow he'll have some numbers for me as to how much that will be. And also at the same time, sometime I'm meeting him here first thing in the morning tomorrow, and then later in the day I'm meeting a representative from a company, Universal Electric. They're the people that did the original lighting in the gym and the lighting out in the parking lot. And I'm going to ask them about a project in all of the classrooms to replace the fluorescent lighting with LEDs.
Is that part of the green?
They both have really good paybacks to them. So if we can put them together and get them bid and get them done in time, which is going to be a stretch, I'm sure they'll
well, I guess my problem with this is that we've known this. We talked about this still when Marty was here, that we had $130,000. And it almost seems like we don't want to spend that money on doing things in the building. The wheel is really grinding to a halt on this, and I'm really upset that we have that much money kicking around, and all of a sudden now we're rushing to the gun to get projects on board when we could have had these projects on board much earlier.
Well, I don't disagree with that, Mr. Strosky, except that first of all, we thought this one project was going to take up all the money.
But we knew already a month ago that this was going to be 73,
right.
And we're still sitting in another meeting talking about it when we could have been acting on it.
Right. But I think what each individual school committee tends to forget is that Mr. Lesko and I have four other buildings to take care of. And so we're sort of putting out fires all the time. And unfortunately, routine things that we could be planning get pushed back because we just don't have time to get to it, to put a bid together. And I agree with you, we shouldn't be giving away this money. But with just Mr. Lesko and I to man five buildings, and over the summer we tried to do a lot of work, and we had the roof project, which took up an inordinate amount of our time over the summer. We're scrambling.
I don't think, you know, I fully appreciate that and understand that, but I don't think Whately presents a burden on either one of you. And I think once, you know, when we have a project that comes along, that it needs some attention.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't feel we got the attention that we needed. And I, you know, maybe that's enough said, but I really don't. I think that we have the money sitting there. We have things that we could do to improve the building, and we need to do that.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I know the selectmen at our meeting, in the meeting that we were at, brought up about the green and asked about.
They want to write another grant, and they're waiting for us to complete this grant.
Right.
And, you know, this grant is due at the end of December.
Right.
So, you know, I said it.
Mm-hmm. No, I think it makes perfect sense. And it's something that we need to focus on. spending a little bit more energy on Whately.
It connects with the capital planning that we were talking about in terms of having a sort of a plan that we can be using going forward so that we aren't caught off guard.
And that's in the works. We will have that by next month.
You know, we asked for that in September for the five-year plan. And we're, you know, we're November and I haven't seen a plan.
Next month.
We, you know, and I'm not trying to make excuses, Mr. Skraski. I'm just trying to let you know that we have had, a lot of our time has been staffing. We lost people here. We lost people in Deerfield. We lost people in Sunderland. We lost people in Frontier. Nobody wants these jobs. And they're good paying jobs. They have good benefits. It's just that there isn't a high pool of people wanting to do custodial work. So we have been shorthanded, and a lot of our time has been spent writing up ads, interviewing candidates. They accept it. We start training them. They're not working out. We have to go back to the drawing board, and that has been taking up a lot of Mr. Lesko's time just to maintain our buildings.
Who interviews the custodians?
Well, Bob and the principal.
And who manages the custodian?
The principal. And Bob has some oversight.
But Patty's Patty's referring, I think, to
more broadly.
People who've come and gone more so in other buildings.
Right. Well, we had turnover here.
We did. We had one. We had to place our evening custodian most recently. Yeah.
Damn fly.
I know. I think we were here last meeting.
Still, we want some chocolate.
All right. Okay. Anything else on that?
All right. Is Bob all set? Are you all done then?
Thanks. All right. Thank you. New business. Discussion of the FY18 budget calendar.
So can I just skip back to the financial statements for a second? Because I forgot to tell you that you signed 6 warrants tonight for $32,453.62.
Okay.
Sorry. Just got a
back. For how much?
32.
Mm-hmm.
53. Sorry.
Did you get it? No. Didn't get it.
Okay.
There's no first or second, huh?
No. That's just a report. Okay, so we put the school calendar in your packet for you. So starting next week, the superintendent and I will be meeting with each individual principals to get their ideas for staffing, what their needs are going to be for their building. Then what will happen is I will take all that basic information and superintendent and I will also meet with the directors of curriculum, the director of maintenance, the director of technology, and get their wants and desires for FY18. We will then spend that time putting all that data together. And then during the week of December 12th, we'll have our final budget meetings with the superintendent and our principals for each of their buildings. And then we will be getting all the documentation together to give you your packets on January 9th, which will be our first meeting in January. February 6th, we will continue our deliberations. Sometime February or March, we usually get called by the Whately Select Board or Finance Committee to come in and present our budgets. March 6th, we will have our public hearing. Now, we usually had the public meeting at 6 and then our meeting at 7. So do we want to just keep the public hearing at 6 with our meeting immediately following so that we don't have to wait till 7 o'clock?
Right.
So we'll do immediately following.
That might be 6:05.
It could. There's nobody here.
Yeah. Is it possible to change that meeting if I'm going to be away out of town that day?
That would be up to the committee.
We would have to vote on it, wouldn't we?
You guys would have to vote.
I don't mind changing the meeting, but we've got to figure out your schedule.
Right, because we've got 4 other meetings.
Right, so I'm away that whole week.
You're away that whole week. Mm-hmm. let me see what our schedule is.
Maybe you want to look and propose something next time.
Yeah. We could do the 13th. That'll just give us the 13th, 14th at Frontier, and then.
Okay, so we want to change that meeting to Monday.
The 13th.
Yeah, the 13th. When do we vote on it? December.
Or do we vote tonight?
No. Oh, the they can change the calendar at any time.
Well, okay, we have to vote on it.
Yeah, so Katie can make a motion to change.
Can I make a motion to change from the March 6th to March 13th?
Okay, let's see.
And that still gives us enough time when we vote our budget to get it to the town and it meets their timeline.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Change the...
The March 6th of 17 meeting to March 13th of 17.
Bob, you want to second that?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. March 13th.
I just don't want to be a thorn in the side here, but typically we got our budgets in December and we started deliberations in January.
With Marty changed that, Don. When her second year here, we started giving them out in January.
Okay, I'm just,
December was too early.
There
was no way we'd be starting our budgets in October, and we all find by the time it's already difficult getting them ready in November, December to present to you in January, with how everything changes, and we don't know what the insurances rates are until January, so we're going with some pretty good guesses in December to hand out in January. If we started November to hand them out in December,
okay, I'm fine with it. I needed to ask the question.
Nope, that's fine. And then your town meeting is scheduled for April 25th here at Whately Elementary, and June 13th is your town elections. Is anybody up for election this year?
I think I am.
Okay. Just you?
Just
one at a time.
Yeah. Oh, one at a time? Okay, so Mr. Skrowski is up for re-election.
Okay. You all set with that then?
I am, unless anybody else has any other changes.
Okay. School improvement plan, Pete.
All right, so this came out to you with the rest of the package, and I'm wondering if you had a chance to review it, because it'll let me know just how much I should say about it or see if you have any questions about it. It's first and foremost, it's a different format than what you've seen before, hopefully easier to read and easier to understand. And I did annotate it significantly on the first page just to give you an idea of what we've moved away from on the school improvement plan and why, and what we've decided to move into. This is not a bad time for me to give you a quick reminder of what the school council's role is. And school council, according to state regulation, they advise the principal on, they review the budget with the principal, and they advise the principal on anything in the budget that they may have questions or concerns about, and then they also work together with the principal to develop a school improvement plan. They can have more authority, but that's at your pleasure. If school committees can always ask school councils to pursue an initiative or something like that. So this particular school council has been excellent in terms of really thinking globally about our school, not just in the instructional realm, but also in the social-emotional realm, and certainly in the community realm. And I think that what you're seeing in this school improvement plan that we're recommending is exactly that. There is the academic piece around what we're doing with kids and the diversity of learners that come into our building. There's a whole section on community connections too, which I think is real important to this particular school council. They would like to see us continue the efforts that we've done in the past in terms of really reaching out to the community and staying connected, both with our parent community and our wider community, and really want to bump it up a little bit, and came up with some very, I thought, creative ideas, including workshops where parents and teachers might attend together. Professional learning, you know, we talk a lot about professional learning communities and the training that we do for our staff, but it would be very fun, I think, and rewarding to have parents and staff work together in a professional learning community, whether it's around a specific topic or maybe it's just something very generic like, tell us more about this math that none of us know how to do, but the kids are learning how to do, you know, topics like that. And then lastly, we're really looking at the early childhood years. I think there's initiatives. I think, again, for us, the timeliness of this is very good because across the state, there is more and more focus on the early childhood years. I brought just one example that the Mass Elementary School Principals Association and the collaboratives around the state are offering more and more opportunities to talk about early childhood initiatives. I think if it's one thing that we know in public education, which is why we keep coming back to early childhood, is that those are the critical years. So that's when we can do the most important work with students, is to really give them a good start educationally, academically, socially, emotionally, in life. So the school improvement plan reflects some of that thinking. And I also want to suggest to you that this really should be a fluid document, one that we can grow into, one that we can change along the way. And while we moved from a three-year plan a few years back to a one-year plan, I hope that this committee will understand and accept that next year, as this plan evolves and as we do some of the work that we hope to do, that you'll see a very similar plan, but of course it will, you know, it'll be updated and changed a little bit. If we can keep it fluid, that's helpful for us to do that. I'll probably stop right there and see if you had any questions from your reading of it while I'm looking it over.
I saw an early childhood innovation is that we have full day preschool back on here as a
wish,
as a topic or a wish.
I would have to say it's more of a wish than anything else right now. I think that certainly I would like to see us have a full day preschool again. There is the feasibility of it financially, but some schools around us are busting at the seams, and I don't know what it would take to really make to spread those kids around. I don't know if traditionally we haven't done that. Mm-hmm. I know that parents like to send their kids to preschool in their hometown school, but if we can see our way clear to having parents go to various schools around our district, I think our preschool could be successful all day long, and we would take the burden off of a school like Sunderland, for example, who is, you know, just work literally opening new classrooms to support their early childhood kids. And I think we didn't give our full day preschool enough time to develop a market. If you remember, we did it for 1 year only, and then we were concerned that we might lose too much money in the second year. We also reacted to the fact that a local early learning center or pre-K was supposed to close, and then they decided they didn't. They got a new owner, and I think that convinced, you know, some folks that the timing wasn't right for us to stay as a full day preschool. But I think it's necessary. I think the students are out there, the families are out there.
Well, I was just going to say, so what is the process for evaluating that? Because I know we talked about the last budget cycle, and I do think it would be good to look at what the cost would be and what the opportunity is, because I agree, I think there is a big opportunity, and it makes sense that Whately would fill in some of that capacity.
I can speak to the fact that we have upped the three-year-old program in Sunderland, so mm-hmm. that is now a full-day program. We have a full-day three-year-old and a full-day four-year-old. The need is that great.
Mm-hmm.
And we did talk about, talking to you folks about coming down here and expanding, or even just asking if we could use a room.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, at the time, in the middle of the year, it was last month, it just didn't fall into place. I think that, you know, finding out the costs and, filling it with the students is definitely worth looking at.
I was going to say, I don't know the history or the rationale, maybe politics is the right word, for why kids tend to go to do preschool in their own town. Maybe Don, in your institutional memory and history, you may understand that. But it seems odd to me, and again, maybe it's a regionalization thing, there's that R word again, but it seems odd that we have one of our schools, or maybe more than one, that are really doing everything they can to just accommodate kids, and here we have a great classroom, and we run a half-day program, and we could certainly do more.
Go ahead, I'll let you go first.
I guess I didn't follow you on the demographics that you were talking about, why kids go to their preschool and
One of the things that I've noticed is that there seems to be a reluctance, or again, I'm not sure the reason for the rationale behind it, but most of the kids that we've always had in our pre-K are Whately kids. And when there was discussion of, can we get a Sunderland kid over here or a kid from another town, My impression in the past is that it was not necessarily something that we wanted to do.
Oh, I don't think so.
But,
no.
Okay, well, that's good to know, because if that's a barrier that we don't have to live by, then that's a good thing.
I guess how I look at it, and I've been in town for X amount of years, you've been here longer, you know, if we don't have the young families having kids in this town, and if you're thinking about kids in Whately coming to our preschool for a half a day or full day, if we don't have enough of young kids in our town to fill it, to make it that, you know, we're not losing a lot of money or something, I mean, that's a reason why we closed down. Like, did we give it enough a chance? Maybe not. But there again, if we don't have, you know, reason why we brought it aboard, because Pine Brook or whatever the name of the place over here closed down, but then the next thing you know, the person that worked there bought it, and a lot of people were going back there instead of coming to us here. But there again, in the case of Sunderland, not to knock Sunderland, but from year to year, those numbers could change drastically because they have a lot more apartments than we do in Whately here. So that number, this year we opened up third grade, but next year we might be combining them over in Sunderland if a bunch of families decide to move out of town.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how.
It's tricky to predict, but I think quality of program overrides everything.
And quality
I think
of
if
program.
We can show that, yep. This, and I know this has a very good reputation, but honestly, full-time parents are never going to come here because
exactly.
2 hours a day does nothing.
Yeah,
but we can offer, you know, before school, we can offer mm-hmm. full day,
yeah.
quality full day, and then after school, and that would meet a lot of needs.
I think that's what you need to think about.
Right, and that needs to become.
And there are, again, they're looking at where are they going to place a classroom,
mm-hmm.
a full day pre-K classroom mm-hmm. for 3-year-olds in the Sunderland building.
Right.
So the thing is, you've got the room, you've got the seats, you've got quality program, excellent teacher.
Mm-hmm.
But the question is it impacts the budget.
Mm-hmm.
But you get some of those kids and they come here and then they're used to coming here and then they stay in our school and they stay in Whately
uh-huh.
as opposed to going to other schools.
Well, maybe I would try last year to get more information about the pricing and how the revenue is. I mean,
yeah.
It's a little bit like the food, the cafeteria. You need to get full pay people in to offset the other end of the spectrum.
Right.
And so again, it gets back to kind of the quality of the program, I think.
The quality and the availability.
And the availability.
I mean, I think if the word is out there over the course of a year or two, then
right.
people
It'll
learn about it and they hear about it. And, you know, I don't think that's what we missed out on
yeah.
last time, Bob. We had it for 1 year and then it was gone.
Yeah.
And it's in that second and third year when people say, oh yeah, Whately, we forgot about Whately. They have full day now. And they have for 2 years and we've heard good things. And, you know, we just never gave ourselves a chance to get there.
I guess the way I would look at it, at the numbers that we have, and if we decide to offer full, and we have X amount of people, and that money comes in, there's a pot of money, but we have to have the full-time teacher, and we have to have the aide here with the full-time teacher. You know, what's that cost going to be? And if we do a 2-year pilot again or something like that, How much is it going to cost us?
I'd like to see an analysis done.
That's a great idea.
To show us
what
we need, how many kids we need to have to support the program.
Right.
The reason it was dropped last time, frankly, is because we didn't have the kids and it was costing a lot of money to run the program.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the towns were stretched. And so we, you know, we fell into that as well. So, I mean, it wasn't that we didn't want the program.
Mm-hmm.
It was a financial situation.
We were hoping that the other place did stay closed down and we were going to reap the benefits of them
yeah.
over there. And it should, you know.
You know,
it seems like since then there's been also an increase in demand.
I think.
Given how the other school, like, so it was just timing partly
yeah.
too.
Well, I think parents are becoming educated that preschool is really
important,
critical.
Yeah.
And there's an extreme advantage to attending preschool and not. Attending preschool and the development of your child. And I think parents are becoming more educated
mm-hmm.
and aware of that, and they're seeking these kinds of programs. So I think the thing we need to do is figure that out, what we need to do to support it, have some costs in front of us, and then we can make some really intelligent decisions. And I agree, Bob, I think if we do it, it should be a 2-year pilot Because I think 1 year wasn't enough.
Yeah, for the marketing aspect, we need some time. Well, thank you for that. I mean, I didn't intend to, I didn't really think that it would come up as a major discussion.
Well, I saw.
No, I'm glad you brought it up.
I saw a bunch of things that stuck in my mind because, you know, I was for opening, and then when I think Regina's the one that came back and said, hey, we're not getting enough out of it. My suggestion is to close it, and we did. And I think there was a few people upset, and it was you know, I felt bad, but, you know.
Yeah, but it's a, you know, it is also several years beyond now, and we're seeing this incredible increase, not only in need, but literally children who have, who really need this early intervention.
Right.
And, again, we're expanding in Sunderland to meet that need, but we've got this great program here, and we're not that far away.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess.
And we did talk about it. We did talk about it.
Mm-hmm. I guess how else I look at it, and, you know, I'm looking at it as a, yes, as an educational, but it's also, we, you know, it's like a babysitting service a little bit. Okay, I look at it that, you know, hey, if I'm paying for childcare 5 days a week or 4 days a week for my kid at 3 years old or 4 years old, we'll say to say the 3 year old, the 4 year old should be in preschool, but if it's costing them X amount of dollars and it's going to cost them less to come here, I mean, I'm just bringing it up as.
Well, you.
I remember how much I used to pay for my kids to go to a babysitter for all those years, my two girls, you know, it just.
I don't know if you heard, just last week NPR did a thing on early childhood. And the woman they spoke to, a, you know, federal level person who's involved in early childhood across our country, and she said that they did a very extensive survey of parents, and they were a little surprised at what they learned. The top two factors that parents are looking for in early childhood daycare, whether it's a private daycare or a school daycare, is location. They need convenience, and they want people who are going to love my kids, who are going to take care of my kids. That's what they look for. They don't think about what's your curriculum look like. They don't think about early intervention services necessarily. They want convenience and people who are going to love their kids. And so knowing that is good for us.
Right.
Because we can market the both of those things, that we are a convenient spot for a number of towns around us, and of course kids are going to get a lot of TLC, as they always do.
It's a wonderful program here. It is so sweet, and she is wonderful.
Yeah, and you know, in that realm too, we also would like to reach out and create a better bridge with the early intervention providers around here. Schools often don't have a hand in that first IEP that might get written for a kid who has special needs. It kind of comes to us from early intervention. It'd be nice if we could bridge that gap a little bit and have, you know, have someone at the table when early intervention is working with those kids before they get to us. Mm-hmm. So we've had some input and able to support their IEP, more opportunities for parent education, all of that kind of stuff. But anyway.
Well, it could also be a pipeline for new school choice.
And it could be, for sure.
Which we need to keep an eye on. Also.
Absolutely.
So if we do an analysis and bring the cost back to you, would you be interested in factoring that into, or deciding whether or not to factor it into the budget we're building right now?
I would like to.
Factor it in, and then we can work from there.
I would like to do that.
Absolutely.
Too.
Good. I know you'd be happy.
So we need to move it. I'll talk to Kim.
Yes.
McCarthy, and maybe we can get that ball rolling.
Have you all met Kim McCarthy?
No. Okay.
Once.
I'm going to have her come to one of our meetings.
Yeah.
Perhaps, maybe even next month. She's world class. She's top notch.
Yeah.
She really knows her stuff. She's our early childhood, early elementary.
She works with Rhonda, right? Is that the one
Rhonda
that
works
with her.
For her, but she is in all the buildings and all the kindergarten and pre-K. And so, and like I said, Whately was the top of the discussion that we had. It just.
What's happening at Deerfield, their preschool? Are they expanding as well, or?
Right now, they have the one full day program, as far as I know, and
Because they've gone down with kindergarten, right?
I think they tried to.
No, they went back up. They went back up. They have three, but they gave one of the kindergarten classrooms to pre-K.
I think they have two pre-K classrooms there, if I'm not mistaken.
Do they have two?
Because they were here this summer, both, I think both classrooms were here.
I think they, that's what I heard, that they had gone to two. They only had one before.
And, yeah, there's three kindy classes, and then there's the pre-K. I want to say they're full day.
Well, I can say.
Well, my kids went to Deerfield, so they definitely have a full day. I just don't know if the second one is full day.
I don't know.
I think one is three-year-old, one is four-year-old. And they wanted to do that over at Sunderland. The problem is the room, you know. When the schools were built, they were built for kindergarten to grade six. And now the push is, and we know so much more now, that we pushed it to four-year-olds, and now we're actually going to three-year-olds. And the schools, you know, were built K to six. We don't really have the extra classrooms for these little ones. And so it makes it a little hard, even at.
Whately was at the forefront of that, because we did plan for preschool when we built this building.
That's, well, I do know that one of the kindy classrooms in Deerfield has to be in the 1-2 hallway, because the preschool went from one room to two rooms, and then there's two kindy, so there's four rooms there, and another kindy is over in the first grade.
Wow. Let's see, I was thinking Deerfield, it's easier to transition from Deerfield to Whately in a way, without the bridge. You know, people, the parent, the convenience factor, coming over to Whately from Sunderland may be a little bit less attractive, but it'll be good to look at the different opportunities.
Your interest in letting us do a little research right now.
Yeah,
thank you for that.
I think, especially in light of what's happening in Sunderland, you know, because if they do, if they move to, you know, like a three-year-old full-day program, they're going to cut slots, because if you're doing full-day, you can only do so many kids full-day, whereas before it'd be, you know, AM and PM. So now they've got the full-day, so we should go full-day, and then we could, you know, get, build up our, over in this building, build up the population for that.
Well, so I think part of our problem when we did it before was that, you know, we had the one program, and we had kids that were going half day, and then some that were staying full day, and the numbers in the full day program were down. I mean, there weren't very many kids, and that's what was killing us.
Was it an option for all the kids?
Yeah, when we did it for that 1 year, we had a combination of AM kids, PM kids, and full day kids.
Generally speaking, 4 year olds do great full day. Sometimes 3 year olds are too small. But they're found in Sunderland, the three-year-olds, certain ones that they have need to be there full day. They, you know, to make the kind of progress they need to be there full day.
I think part of it is marketing. I think families here know there's a 2 hour or the half day, so they're used, they're kind of thinking they're going to send their kids to that.
To,
so it's kind of a different market that would go for the full day.
So in preschool, there's only, I'm just looking at the thing, there's 12 kids in there right now doing half, 12 of them are doing half days, 4 days a week, right?
Yep.
Are the other programs
in Sunderland
5 days a week?
It's only 4 days a
week. 5 days a week.
Okay, so that's something else we should.
Yeah, that we should.
That has to be considered going 5 day. I mean, if you're going to do full day,
right? If you're going to tap into the working parents, then you have to offer.
And so I'm surprised that you had tried it and it didn't work, because did you see, you know, early and after school, out of school time care as well?
It certainly was available to everybody, just like it is now, yeah. Well, I think that part of it was some of the things that we discussed. We probably don't need to belabor the point. I mean, I think that part of it was that we did have a mix of half-day kids, full-day slots. We weren't hitting the full-day slots very well. The half-day slots weren't enough to cover the costs. You know, that sort of thing is what happened to us.
If we go full-day, it's full-day. Like the other schools, right? They don't have partial, do they?
I can't speak to the other programs.
I mean, that's what I would say is, if you're going to do it.
If you're going to do an analysis, do that part too.
Yeah, I mean, Kim could probably
guide us. What are the other schools doing? How successful are they, you know?
And I'm sure Kim could guide us around, you know, if we did have half-day slots, they'd be limited, I would assume.
Right,
you know,
or how many full-day do you need to make it work, and then you can fill in with half-days after that.
Good. Anyway, that was one item. Just back to the larger plan, if there's anything else that you'd like to ask me about, I'd be happy to explain.
That's only thing, believe it or not, that's the only thing that caught my eye that I had a question about. I like all the other ideas, I like this way you have it versus in the past, Pete, I mean, it...
Yeah, it's definitely easier to read.
Yeah, a lot easier.
I wanted to do that, for sure.
The question that I have, not to be a stickler here, but whenever form was passed, it was the school committee's obligation to approve the school improvement plan.
Yes.
And then when it was revisited, that power was taken away from the school committee, and I don't know if that's changed.
Not the most recent...
It calls for...
The most recent regulations I've read still say that school committee reviews and approves. But in the past, you've always given us your blessing. You haven't always voted on it.
But I don't have a problem with that, because...
I'll look up the regulations again, because I'm pretty sure I printed them post-reform, and the regulations still say that school committee reviews and approves.
Yeah, that's my understanding.
I'll make a motion.
Can I just make one more comment? I do want to applaud the effort to get the parents more involved.
Yes, I just think that down community outreach.
I think that that will be really positive in building just more community, and I think it's good that you guys put that in there.
Agreed, thank you, Katie.
I'll make a motion to approve the 2016-2017 school improvement plan.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we're on to reports. No, I have nothing to report. I reported on the land situation. So anything on the collaborative?
They haven't had a meeting since.
Okay. Principal.
Okay, so I also left one in front of you tonight, and again, this is very informational, just nothing too heavy on here, more just giving you an idea of what's going on. We have our Veterans Day Assembly this Thursday, like we do every November, at 2:15. You are always welcome to come and join us, although I know your jobs might keep you away. It's been a great opportunity for us to have Mike Anderson working with our teachers. He started out being brought into our district by the good folks in Deerfield, and now he's been working with us across the district. His specialty, this is a nationally renowned presenter, and his specialty is around differentiating instruction. And right now he's talking to us and our teachers around differentiating using choice for kids, and what I mean is literally giving kids choice in the classroom about how would you like to tackle this assignment, this way, that way. You know, it's too much to get into for an explanation for you now, but I wanted to distinguish it from we think of choice. I'm not talking about school choice, I'm talking about giving kids choices on how they go about their academics. And he also uses a peer coaching model, which we are just getting underway with here in Whately. Some of the other schools, you know, Louise has been taking Mike around to the various schools. Our sixth grade teacher taught a lesson, and two of her colleagues critiqued the lesson and gave feedback. A number of people observed the lesson, but only certain people give feedback to the lesson. And the way he sets it up is that teachers hear three positives and one push. Okay, three things that the observers thought they did well, and then one suggestion about what they may do differently. And it's an excellent model that in many other fields, it's used all the time. People are observed and they get immediate feedback. But in education, we don't do it nearly as often as we could. And it's also not an easy thing to put yourself through. You know, when you teach a lesson and your colleagues are watching you, it can be a little hair-raising. But the first experience that my sixth grade teacher had, and she was the brave soul who did it first, she said it was very positive in the end. And so we're going to continue that model later this week and have a few more people teach and be observed. Also on that same day, our fifth grade trip to Boston, so it won't be our fifth grade teacher who's teaching that day because she'll be in Boston. Just wanted you to be aware of that trip. And this is a combined trip this year with the folks from Deerfield. Usually this trip happened in the spring, but for a variety of reasons, we decided to join forces with Deerfield. It saved a little bit on cost. So it'll
be a nice
opportunity.
Is that the Freedom Trail?
Kathy O'Rourke.
I think I went to the first one that Jim Galunas did down there with one of my girls. Can't tell you what one of my girls. It was fun. It was really good.
I don't know if any of you knew Tom Waskevich, but Tom is a 4-H guy and a former school teacher. And he paid me a visit along with Ruth Fairman, who's been involved with our school now for a number of years, as her role as a Grange person. And Tom is looking to start a new 4-H group and is looking for some support from the school. I told him I would be more than happy to offer that support in the way that we might be able to. The real key, of course, when you start a 4-H group is not finding the kids, it's finding the parent leaders. So anyway, this is very, very preliminary, but I just wanted to put it in front of you just to let you know that we're talking about it. And I also wanted to let you know that we've had our second all-school meeting, which was just awesome. It was almost entirely run by kids. The teachers stepped in every now and then with a little reminder, you know, now you read this card. But first graders and fifth graders ran the meeting, and it was very, very nice and very positive. But I also included just some language around why we have moved to the all-school model. It's a responsive classroom approach, which we've always used. But we started, as you know, doing all-school sings, and then someone said, well, we should take that a step further and do an all-school meeting where there's maybe a demonstration of greeting skills, or some activities that activate the brain, and the second meeting was just great. I mean, the first meeting was planned by adults, and it was nice, but the second meeting was planned by adults and students, and the students ran it, and I thought it was great. But some of the things that you see at the bottom of the page in bold are the reasons we do all school meetings. They're really about community building and social emotional well-being, and I'm very happy that we've moved in that direction. And we look forward to more. The way we're doing it right now is that all of our classrooms have reading buddies. So, for example, fifth grade and first grade are reading buddies. And the reading buddy classrooms are going to each take a meeting, and then we'll probably start the process over, and everybody will get a second one before the year is over. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful Madam. Things going on in at Whately. Wonderful things. So I left a copy of the superintendent's report. The MASC and the MASS met their annual joint conference. We met last week. I went for the first time. And I had six committee members. And it was actually time well spent. We went to some really, really good workshops. We talked a lot. We didn't really talk a lot about school, but we talked a lot about education. A lot of discussion around charter schools and that kind of thing. So I listed the members of the school committees that came, and then I listed a few of the ones that that I attended and some that the other ones attended. And I actually went for a lot of them to dealing with the finance, the finance portion of running the district. But I did go to social emotional learning, and I did go to practical. That was a keynote: practical strategies for supporting children with anxiety-based oppositional behaviors. So to understand, it was very interesting because the perspective she had was that the students, they're oppositional, and they're not oppositional. Sometimes, you know, we need to be able to think a little bit deeper when we look at them. That, yeah, they're difficult, and you can't get them to do anything, and this and that, but really, what's going on? And they talked about behavior plans and how they're not really that effective because you can't incentivize learning or behavior. So saying you'll get a point if you're good for 30 minutes really isn't that. So I also am writing a little bit to let you know that all the children in the district grades 3 to 6 will be tested will be taking the assessment, the MCAS 2 assessment on computers this spring. We had the option of paper pencil or computerized. If you chose to go computerized, you'd be held harmless for the test scores. And it would give us a chance to acclimate our teachers, our instructors, our students to taking the test on the computer. We already do computerized testing. This year we're doing it 3 times a year. I asked when I came if we could do the NWEA MAPS test in January as well as the spring and the fall and the spring. And so we're doing it in January. And so the kids are, the students will be pretty well primed anyway to take the test on the computer, but we'll learn so much by going through this pilot computerized test. And we're actually going right up to eighth grade. But definitely Union 38, 3-6 will be doing it. And then I am meeting with the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition. I do want to talk to you a little bit about it so you understand what it's about. But also, too, at the last meeting I went to, State Senate President Stan Rosenberg was there, and he talked about the RISE Act that he and a group of others have been trying to get passed. My understanding, and I could be wrong, but my understanding is it got passed through the Senate, but not the House. So next year they're going to tweak it and push it through again. And what it does is it actually is putting more accountability on charter schools. They really want to, there's 4% of the students in the state go to charter schools, but the teachers don't need to be as trained or certified as public school teachers. The schools don't generally take the special ed students or the physically disabled or the behaviorally challenged students, as we in public schools have to take everyone. And so what they want to do is kind of balance that a little bit with what, and that's what the RISE Act, and the RISE stands for Reform, Innovation, and Success in Education. So it was really interesting. It involves beefing up the charter school boards, and I understand, I could be wrong, but I think giving school districts $1,000 per student more when the students choose to go to charter schools to help offset the cost. Now, conversely, the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition is a little different. It really doesn't have anything to do with charter schools. What it has to do with is the Chapter 70
funding.
And what it is Mike Bonacani is working on his doctorate, and this is sort of the thing he's doing, his project for it, and he has come up with a set of tiers. All our schools are in the tiers, and what the tiers have to do with is several things, but mostly it's declining enrollment. So Whately Whately's in tier 5 or tier 6, but what that means is the schools with the there's different things it's balanced on, and the tiers are based on declining enrollment criteria, eligibility, and targeted aid. So a school like Athol Royalston is a district like that. They're tier 1, they have a high poverty, high declining enrollment, high student school choice. Whately has a declining enrollment, but they're, the Chapter 70 fund, the real estate that goes into defining Chapter 70 and the enrollment. So they would be asking for, rather than using a flat formula, which is what the Chapter 70 uses, the foundation budget and by the enrollment, they would base it on these tiers, and so we would get more funding because we're a school district that has a declining enrollment, and the most needy districts with the largest declining enrollment would be tier 1. Most of our schools fall into the tier 4, 5, or 6, but Whately does fit into that because our the idea being that small schools are wonderful, and there's a ton of research, and you can find the information anywhere how important small schools are, but it also costs more to operate a small school, and therefore we shouldn't be using the same flat formula they use in the big cities and in the urban formula. So I wanted you to be aware of that. They had asked that I present it to you and have you
vote to agree to become part of the coalition or to support the coalition. Right now, I'm taking kind of a conservative wait and see thing. I'm not sure where it's going to go, but I do want you to be aware of it. It's interesting, if you read the Gazette or you read the Recorder, you'll see a lot of, you know, Mike is in there a lot with this rural schools thing. And I've talked to people, you know, when I was at the conference, I talked to other people, and I really, really want, before I go all in starry-eyed, I just want to take kind of a cautious look. But I am connected, I do go, I listen, I take the notes, I have a file, but I just want you to be aware of it. I'm not asking you to vote one way or the other. When I become convinced that this is the way for us, then, you know, I'll bring it to you and I'll have them come and really sell it to you.
Well, I imagine his, in the Mohawk district, most of their schools got to be in the 5-6 tier level, the elementary schools.
Well, I would think they're a little bit even higher, because tier one is, you know, the poorest with the most declining enrollment and the highest need. So, you know, they would ask like $1,000 extra per student. Whereas we get down to tier five, they're asking $100 per student, or changing the funding.
Isn't there some big case going on in Connecticut where they've found that, you know, like Bridgeport should be getting more funding, and Greenwich has so much funding, yeah, they should be spreading? This is sort of that same idea.
Yes, it's the equity.
Right.
The big schools, the big urban mm-hmm. schools, dollar for dollar are cheaper to run than right. Whately. Mm-hmm. Dollar for dollar, because we have a small population, and that's okay, because small population, I mean, I can bring it, you know, the research is there, small mm-hmm. schools, that's, if I, you know, this is where you want your kids to be, and we're very fortunate that we do have these small schools and these rural schools, but it costs a lot more to keep them open and keep them going, and the aid is not equitable at this point. So the RISE Act is sort of involved in that, but it's really more about putting sanctions on charter schools. Forget the cap, forget question two, but putting sanctions, more sanctions on them. This Mass Rural Schools Coalition is about putting more equity into the funding formula. And I hope I was articulate enough, but I have to tell you, I do want you informed, but I'm not sure. I'm just not sure. They haven't asked us to sign or do anything yet anyway, but they did ask for, you know, for me to get support from you, but I do just want you to know that it's something we're looking at. And Stan Rosenberg was at the last meeting, mm-hmm. but again, there are apples and oranges, what he's trying to do, and it's just a little bit different.
Well, it is. The what Stan's trying to do involves charter schools, mm-hmm. nothing to do with the foundation budget.
No. And what we need to do is see if we can't, because we are rural, see if we can't get a little bit more money.
But I'm glad to see that in Stan's proposal, they're talking about getting some accountability from the charter schools. Mm-hmm. You know, we give them our bucks, and we get no information back what's being done, how it's being spent.
A lot of money.
And I wish this conversation were available for the vote tomorrow, but this is being taped. I wish it was live. Because anybody that has any doubts, believe me, vote no.
Well, they do, and they're able to kind of pick the best and the brightest. They pick someone that's not, they send it back.
Believe me.
So you're
gonna solve all of
them. So that's my report.
Thank you. Just a couple things. I like the idea that you opted to do the assessment computerized. I think it's a good idea so you work out all the bugs. Mm-hmm. Secondly, how are you doing in your little mentor program that you're doing for your superintendency?
Good question. I meet with her 8 hours a month, and I go to a training 8 hours a month. So she essentially comes to me, and she's coming next week. We were supposed to go last week. She wanted to walk a school with me, and I said,
I'd like to go to Whately and see, you know, this is such a beautiful school, it's a beautiful school. So she will be coming with me next week to walk through classrooms. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a protocol as a superintendent when you walk through classrooms, and you know, I walk through with the principals and then I share what I saw, what I see. And we had a little discussion today too, how I get to come in and, oh, you know, this is wonderful, this is beautiful, this is it. And then I walk out and I say, by the way, she shouldn't have been, you know, and then like with the principal, because, you know, so it is going well. I did my entry plan, which is part of it. And then in December, I have to, you know, compile all that information. And I will be presenting that to you as well, what, you know, what, where we're going with that and what strategic plan we have. It's definitely a valuable experience.
That was my next question. Yeah. I think it is.
I don't know. It goes on for 3 years. Mm. I don't know. I think that some people might need a little bit more than others. I'm doing well. I like my coach. I just have to do what they want me to do. And
okay.
Who is your coach?
Her name is Suzanne Skellion, and she was the superintendent in Westfield. I would have normally had Kevin Courtney, because Susan Skellion was a superintendent of a city, mm-hmm. and this is rural, and there's 5 districts, so Kevin was more, but he ended up with so many. I mean, mm-hmm. there's just so many. I think there's 32 new superintendents the year I came in my cohort. And I think there's going to be about 30 again this year.
Wow.
So it's a busy.
Kevin's a great guy, by the way.
He is. And I, you know, so I can call him and I still see him and I do talk to him. But it does help to have that support and to know what mm-hmm. I'm doing. I used her mostly like when I did my opening speech, you know, I ran it by her. When I do, you know, the letters that I put out, the superintendent's messages, you know, I run that by her, you know, and make sure, you know.
Good.
So.
Thank you. Anybody have anything else?
I just wanted to ask, I had asked for an update on the bus management. I don't know, I think you guys might have been talking about something when I came in.
Yeah, well.
Is that something we could talk about next time, maybe?
So, yeah, what is it that you...
I just want to be mindful of one, that the awful accident, but of making sure that we are managing our bus company. Not that we're not managing our bus company, but that I know sometimes parents have questions about the bus company, and I'm not totally clear on how the district, how it works. I know we've talked to Pete, and you usually say it's the superintendent's office that manages that relationship, and I don't know what safety procedures we have, you know, in terms of checking every year, what the bus company is doing to make sure.
So you want to know what the bus, because the bus company has specific things they must do. In mm-hmm. order to be a bus driver, you have to go through all this
right,
training.
Like that would be helpful to know, for parents to know. You know, putting your kids on a bus with a stranger and no seat belts is the first thing you do pretty much when you send your kids to school. And it's a pretty mm-hmm. scary thing. So it would be nice the more information we could provide to parents about that.
I don't think teens have changed since we were in
school. No,
other than back in our day, or your day.
Don was driving.
No, in our day, they used to put chains on the bus and kids went to school.
In the snow.
Did they ever do that when you were a kid?
We didn't have buses.
Oh, that's why you guys walked to school.
Uphill both ways.
We had a horse and buggy. When I went to school, we used a horse and buggy.
Okay. You're not that.
Yeah, well, I can certainly have Patty. Patty's the one that handles the transportation.
Okay.
But I can have her find out what he does. There are certain things they do. They walk around the bus every mm-hmm. time before they get in and when they get off. And they check everything. It's almost like an airplane. They have a whole checklist of things they do before they get in the bus to drive.
And I'm sure they do things. I just think it would be helpful to know more about that.
Sure. Yeah, they have to do that stuff. And as far as the tragedy, that was a tragedy, but I think we need to wait and see when the investigation's done. I'm not sure.
Well, the superintendent mentioned that he's going to be talking about this with a lot of superintendents around the country, and I just, that always caught my eye, you know, why he feels the need to do that, so I do think it's worth paying attention to.
Well, people have questions. I mean, that's why...
I think it's not even a question of, it was just a very...
It was a horrible accident. Yeah. I'm not saying there's any blame anywhere, right. I just think it reminds you to pay attention to, how things are managed and make sure...
How 1 second could change everything.
Yeah, that can happen anytime.
I have actually spoken to him, and he's the same superintendent that's doing this rural schools thing.
Oh, okay.
So, I do see him often, but yeah, I was with him Friday morning, the Friday morning of the accident, and it was, you never know what's going to happen. So, you want, the bus company training procedures that our drivers...
Do we get a report every year about incidents maybe that happened, just to sort of keep monitor? Does anything? I don't know.
We haven't had any incidents.
That's good. So that would be good to report.
Yeah.
I think the only time we get incidents when we have a parent that complains that Johnny is not being picked up at the end of this street. Why is he being picked up here? I think for the most part, that's the only time I remember having problems. And Johnny, how come he's not getting picked up at the end of the cul-de-sac, and he's getting picked up at the beginning of the road? You know, that's the only time I ever remember anything. How about you?
Yeah, it's very yes. Well, as a school committee member, none.
Yeah.
As a principal, a little different because
you manage day-to-day behavior
stuff.
There's
the management that goes on within the buses and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So.
Every once in a while.
I mean, we've come a long way where the buses used to run for 20, 30 minutes out here and polluting the air to shutting the buses off. I mean, we've come a long way with certain things to help a lot of things, the environment,
Well, I could...
I think safety's gotten a lot better.
Katie hit it right on the nose. It's just a heightened sense of awareness when these things happen, I mean? And it's a good time to bring it up and make sure we're doing what we're supposed to do. We're paying attention.
I would imagine Lenny is, whenever that happened Friday,
I'm sure
Monday morning, there was meetings going on with his drivers before they went out. Extra awareness.
It was something so simple. It was just a little tiny thing that got caught in the door. And it was a horrible thing. Horrible. Actually, for the district, I sent flowers in the name of the district, Union 38 and Frontier Regional. I sent it to the school, to the staff and students, and I actually got back a very, very, very nice, heartfelt thank you. Because, people, you don't realize how this is impacting the kids and the teachers that worked with her, and how now it's empty. So it is a tragedy.
I'll make a motion to adjourn, sir.
We have a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We are done.